Yes, perfect. Yeah, here we go. So, well, thank you all for joining. This is the first time ever that we do this online. Normally, I would be in New York, but of course, because of the whole situation with to the coronavirus, I couldn't travel. It was actually the day that the travel ban was announced. I should have been traveling, but luckily it came in time before I went to the airport. So we're gonna try this online. This is the first time. I have no idea how that goes. But I prepared something, and we can go over that. This is actually, let me quickly share my screen. Here we go. So this is our third meetup. A question that I have, if it's possible, if you have any questions, then please add them to the messages, because I will also dial in with another machine so that I can see that if you have any questions, that you don't have to unmute for the sound and those kind of things. So let me quickly open that as well. Yeah, so if you have any questions, then just feel free to add them to the chat window. So this is our third meetup. We started doing them from the get-go in Amsterdam, where I'm based myself, and New York and San Francisco. We try to do them every quarter. They started out as the Knowledge Graph meetups, but we actually learned that we want to build it more around our open source software, Weaviate. For the simple reason that we see that people start to become interesting in what Weaviate actually can do besides just building knowledge graphs, the semantic features that it has, etc. So therefore, we now rebranded it or renamed it, if you will, the Weaviate meetup. Oh, as I just mentioned, just as a for practical reasons, everybody's already muting, so that's great. I also created the Google Doc, but I think it's actually easier to add the questions to the chat. So then if you have any questions, then I can answer them on the get-go. So I have seven topics on the agenda, things that I also want to show a lot of things. So I have a few things in the deck, but mostly I want to show things from our website. Most importantly, I have a recap. So I've seen a few familiar names in the who joined today. But I just want to do a quick recap for those who are new to understand what we're doing, the background about Weaviate, and what might make what makes the Weaviate different opposed to other solutions out there and how you can use it. I want to show you where you can find Weaviate, so how you can use it. It's an open source solution, so I want to give you some pointers how you can use it. The documentation, of course, is also very important to us, because that's our that is for our users the point of entry. So I want to show a few pointers in the documentation. We have something new, which we call sandboxes. It's still in beta, but I want to demo you what a sandbox is. That's basically a free Weaviate, which you can use for 48 hours. You get that on our network, so I will show also what that is. We've done some updates to our playground, that is the graphical user interface. I want to show a few things about the APIs. And then, of course, if there are any questions, then I would love to answer them. So let's first start off with the recap. The most important, the biggest problem that we've seen in the data landscape is that the moment that we store information in a traditional database or search engine, we lose the context of what actually that data object means. So here you see, for example, had a company with the name Apple, but if we store that data object, we lose the context. Well, that is for the sake of storage, that's perfectly fine, because we now have stored something. But if we want to find it again, it becomes difficult, because the only way that we can now retrieve this data object is actually searching for or company or the keyword name or the keyword Apple. But if you want to search for this on context, so for example, a company related to the iPhone, it becomes very difficult. And another problem what we see in that is that what you see in the two yellow boxes is that for a database, these are just two data entries. They're unrelated to each other. They're just two data entries. But for us, as people observing this and reading this, we know that these two things, Apple and Apple Inc., actually represent the same thing. And that's the problem that we wanted to solve with Weave8. How can we take the next step in offering search engines, indexing of data to people by encapsulating a machine learning model inside Weave8 that actually solves that problem? And the way that we've done that, and that's, if I may say, the novelty in Weave8, is that we do not store the data objects, and here data object is here represented with the orange bulb. We do not store that in a traditional row or column fashion. We don't do that either in a traditional graph fashion, but we do that in a vector space. And the vector space is something that we get from the machine learning model that we use. Our model is, for the data scientists who joined us or people are interested in this, we use a model from Stanford called GloVe, who determines these yellow vector representations. So, for example, they represent Paris, France, and capital, as you can see. And what Weave8 does is that based on the text that is in your data object, so, for example, here, that would be the word company, the word name, and Apple, it tries to determine a new vector position, and that's where it stores the data. So, for example, here you see that Paris, as the capital of France, is stored. So now if you search for things related to France, like Eiffel Tower, you might be able to actually find the capital. And that's how we give context to the data, how we search through it. And later when we go into the API, we have a demo data set where you can actually see that a little bit more closely, how that works. One of the things that I always like to do is, for some people, this concept is a little bit abstract. So what I often do as an example is that I say, as a metaphor, you can think about if you go shopping. So for example, if you have a shopping list and the shopping list contains four items, for example, a banana, an apple, washing powder, and bread, if you enter a store, so let's say that you would go to the Whole Foods. If you enter the Whole Foods and you find actually a banana, then you know that closer by to the banana in the fruit section will be the apple. And if you found the apple, you will actually know that closer by in that space would be the bread. And then you have to move even further to actually find the washing powder. That is a similar way how the data is structured, because it's logically organized. Eh? So the fruits are in the fruit section, but if you zoom out a little bit further, then you actually also find the bread. So now you're in the food sections, where you will find the fruits, but also the foods. In the food section, you will find the fruits, but also, for example, the bread. But Bob, of course not. Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. I don't see your screen.
Oh. I can others see my screen? Because I am screen sharing. Yes. So I'm getting back that others can see my screen. Yeah, everybody. Yeah. So it should be visible, David. So to recap this is a metaphor that I often use, how that data is organized. And every time when we add a new product, so let's say that we now would add a kiwi, then we know that we need to do that somewhere near the banana and the apple. Based on that, within Weave8, we've created three features, and they're going basically from our biggest feature to more added features. And the biggest feature is what we have is semantic search. What makes semantic search in Weave8 different from traditional data solutions that you have with traditional search is exactly as I just described, that, for example, if we have the word, the company with the name Apple, we must type in the word company or the word name or the word Apple to find it. But it becomes more difficult to actually find it based on context. And this vector space that we use in Weave8, which we call the contextionary, brings that context to the data. So now you can actually find more. On top of that, we also have something called automatic classification. What we do with automatic classification is actually the reverse of semantic search. So we can say like, well, if you have certain data objects in your data set, so as you can see here in the image, you see here cars, for example, it can actually automatically make those relations. We have two types of classifications, which I can also show in a bit. And we have something which we call knowledge representation. That's a little bit more abstract, but it's more related to everything what's happening now for in knowledge management and knowledge graphs and those kind of things. Because Weave8 represents the data in a graph-like fashion. You don't necessarily have to use it like that, but that's how we structure it. So that means that if you want to build knowledge graphs or knowledge structures in Weave8, you can do that as well. And I will demo that also in a bit. So where to find Weave8? One of the things that we have drastically changed over the past few months, so the last 3 months, is actually our documentation. So of course, if you just, let's even start with Google. So if you just, I should type as well. Documentation. So if you look for the Weave8 documentation, you see that we got properly indexed. So it's on the SEMI website, and we changed a lot there because we've learned that, of course, the documentation is the point of entry for people to actually find us. So we have videos, we have explanations, we explain the philosophy, and we structured it in a getting started section, setup section, adding data section, querying data set section, etc. So more on how you want to do things. And this is basically how you can get started. And the quick start, we noticed that a lot of people use the quick start guide to actually get started. And this is just a way, like it says 10 minutes, but I think it's even less for you to get started and start using Weave8. Next, we have an important update in the documentation. So for example, if you look at the, let's take for example, the get functionality. So if you look at the functions, so for example, you see we describe how the functions work. But every time when you see an example like this and you see a green bulb here, that means that you can actually click the link after that and it goes to our playground and then it displays the actual query that you see in the documentation. So you see here get things also here, and actually you can run it and you can try that out on the website. So now you can completely try out our news article data set. That's also something that we've done. So one of the demo data sets, which I will show in a bit, is our news publications data set, and everything that you find in the documentation. So let's say, for example, if I go to filters and let's go to the to the get function filter, picking a random filter, then you see that everything is described based on that data set, so that you can try that out. And then here again, you see that green bulb, so I can click that again. You see the query, and then you can actually run the query and play around with that. So those are the most important updates. We take a lot of time to actually work on these pages and design these pages. So if you are going to work with Weave8, or you're going to try it out, and we would love to learn your experience, actually how you're using it, and any advice or tips that you have for us. A lot of updates happen to the Python clients that we have. We keep updating the frequently asked question page. So every time that we get a question, we add it to this page. So there's a lot of information for you to find here. A lot of people also ask about this page, which we've called the philosophy page, where we explain actually more in depth. So here you see these apples again, how Weave8 works, so that you can really go in depth and learn how that works. Then I want to introduce the sandboxes to you. This is a little bit, this is a new thing that we have. So even if you look in the installation guide, you can't see it yet, but it's part of our CLI tool. So I would like to show that to you. We have a tool for the command line, which is called, Weaviate CLI. Which you have it run like this. It's also, if you go to the documentation, and there's for the CLI, there's a separate documentation for the CLI, how you have, where you can run it. And as you can see here, there are three new options there. So we have cluster create, cluster remove, remove, and cluster list. So if I run Weaviate CLI and I say cluster create, and I run this query, then I have old one, so I'm going to remove that. Then you see that it is creating a new cluster on the semi network. So here you get the URL. That's a unique URL that you get for it lasts 48 hours for you to play around with. It takes about 2 to 3 minutes to fulfill the request because it needs to pull in, set up the whole Kubernetes stack and those kind of things. But actually, if you now go to that endpoint, you see that your cluster is being being created, being provisioned. So, and when this is done, we can actually start. You can start using Weaviate on our cloud. So this is a way for you to play around with Weaviate for 48 hours. It's just available for free. We're also going to offer this to the website. So when it's done, I can actually also populate it with some data. So here we see the data sets that we have. We have the news publications data set. We will soon, by the way, be launching some new data sets also to play around with. So one of my colleagues, Laura, for example, is working on a Weaviate for the COVID-19 research. She's working on a Weaviate setup. We also have one for cybersecurity coming up. And so we're going to add those to the website ASAP. But now the one with the news publications, which is also aligned with the documentation, is already on there. So let's see. It's still running, as you can see. Yeah, still provisioning. So it will take a minute more, I think, or so. What I can do in the meantime is that I can already prepare the installation. So if I want to install that, I need to set the Weaviate host. So let me do that here. You get the rel. Yes, so you can see the cluster is now, so you got the message that the cluster is now available. So if I now check that on the meta endpoint, you see there's now a Weaviate just up and running in the network. Well, if you now look at the schema of Weaviate, and let me increase it a little bit, so you see it's empty and there's nothing in there. So it's an empty Weaviate. So one of the things that I can do is that I can say, well, I'm going to now add the demo data set to this Weaviate. So it's actually now importing everything. So for example, if you now go back to the schema, you can see that it actually is adding the schema right now. So it will take a minute or so. As you can see, it's slowly growing. So the whole schema is in now. And then let's see how it's doing on actually adding the things. So as you can see, it also started adding these things. So while this is loading, I can actually go to the next step because I also want to show a little bit more about the playground. So the Weaviate's playground is also available open source. So you can also use that on your local machine. But we also made it available just on the playground.semi.technology. We also made it available like this. It's still in beta. So we haven't released an alpha version or production version yet, but you can perfectly easy, you know, you can just use it, it's just usable. important to mention, if you run Weaviate locally, or if you run Weaviate in the cloud, you can just use the playground, because we don't store any data or something related to that. It's just it runs on our servers, but the actual data that you will see through your Weaviate is something that we don't see that. So one of the things that I can do is that the Weaviate that I just created, I can actually add that here. Well, so what we see now, it's actually loading in the Weaviate that we just created as a sandbox and the schema. So if you, for example, here, look at the schema, we see here the publication, the author, article, and the category. And that's actually, you see that's reflected here as well. So what's important to know is that the Weaviate is completely API based. The only reason for the existence of the what we call the playground is to have a visual layer that you can play around with Weaviate, so that you can create your queries, that you can actually create your schema. So developers use this to actually know how they need to write queries. This is a very simple graph that we have here. This is the news publications graph. So you can see it's all evolving around the articles, which have authors and categories, and they're in publications. And what we now can do is that we can actually start querying this Weaviate like this. We can say, for example, get things, publications, and if we want to see the name, here we see, for example, the all the publications that are currently loaded in this this Weaviate setup. For those who weren't there the last time, the distinction that we make is between where filters, which are traditional structures to search through data. The explore filter is a way for you to use the semantic features that Weaviate has. And so, for example, I can do something like this. I want to search for the concept, let's say business. Let me limit that to the first, just for readability, 3 results. So I'm now going to execute the same query based for these articles, but I'm going to say, like, I would like you to organize them based on the terminology of the concept of business. So if I now run this query, you see this is the result. So it starts with the Financial Times and New York Times Company and then the International New York Times. But it does, as you can see, the word business is not in our data object. Or another one that I often use is, for example, fashion, because that's a very clear result. And then you see, for example, that it comes with Vogue first, and then it chooses the International New York Times. This is how it's how Weaviate is structured and how you can search to Weaviate. These are single objects, but you can also do that for bigger things. So, for example, if you say I want to do that for the actual articles that are in Weaviate, I can say there's a title. And so these are, for example, all articles that are in Weaviate, just in a random order, because I just said, like, I'm searching through them by title. Here I can say, for example, if I now do explore again, then I can say concepts, and then I can say, for example, Beatles, which is one that I often use. Let me also limit that, because it makes it a little bit easier. Oh no, let me actually do that differently. So what you can see here now, it organizes it based on the Beatles. So it obviously starts with John Lennon, but then it goes more into music related. So we see Dave Bowie. So we're still in the realm of music, but we move away from that because the explore function organizes data. But what you can do is that you can actually decrease the amount that you want to search through the vector space. And what we have for that is something that we call certainty. So how certain do you want to be? And what we mean with that is the size that you want to search through the space. So for example, if I put that to, let's say, 72.5%, I decrease the size. And then if I search for it, for example, then you see that only John Lennon pops up. So that's something you can play around with. Also, for the community users, we would love to learn how you use this, and if you have advice for us, how we can improve these queries. And there are way more functionalities in there. And again, if you go to our documentation and you go to the filters, then in Discord, so it's the explore filter get function. Then you see that we also have concepts as move away from, move to, etc., which are explained here, and you can actually also see how that works over here. One more thing that I want to show related to that is the API. I showed a few things from the perspective of the schema API and the things API. One thing that I want to show as well is related to the automatic classification that we have. So we have two types of classification. One is the contextual question. Quick question. So who defines the concept? Is that VBA predefined or user defined, or is it trained per data set? Great question. So currently that is predefined by us. So if you install Weaviate, you choose a language. So of course, what I'm demoing now is English. We also have Dutch for the simple reason that I'm Dutch. We have German. We got requests for Italian and Czech. So we also train them. We call that a basic knowledge currently. So we train on, think about Wikipedia, articles, scientific articles, those kind of things. But of course, there are also situations where you have a very domain-specific question. So for example, think about abbreviations if you work in legal, which of course we can't know. And one of the things that we came up with for that is this, adding synonyms. So if you have a synonym or an abbreviation that Weaviate doesn't understand or can't know, you can actually add that to the extensions endpoint. And so you add a concept, and you just, in natural language, you define what that concept means, and then you can add that concept to Weaviate. One of the goals that we have by design is that we try to not have, so we want to take the hassle away for people to train their own contextionaries. If we see that there's a need for that or that people want that, then of course we can change that and we can make the training available. But we try to really do as much as possible out of the box currently. That brings me actually to the contextionary endpoint. That might be fun to show. So one of the things that we can do is that we have the contextionary endpoint. So if I search for concepts, and then, for example, we just look for the Beatles, you can actually see how the Beatles is stored in the vector space. So this is the vector position that, in this case, the word Beatles has. One of the things that we now have on our roadmap is that was a request that we got from data scientists, that if they fill a Weaviate with data, that they can actually extract everything that they added and get the vector positions for that, so that it becomes easier for them to train custom models. So we're also looking in the UX of data scientists, how we can help them better do their jobs, and this is part of that. But that's currently on our backlog. Let's see, where was I? The classification. So we have two types of classification. One is the nearest neighbor classification. So if things are in the graph and related to each other, then you can see like what's more related to that as well. But the current data set that I have does not have those relations, but we can do the contextual classification. So what the contextual classification does is that it tries to relate nodes to each other if they are unset. And I can actually give you a clear example of that. So let's say, let me do a So I'm now not going to do an explore function, but I'm going to do a traditional function, a search function. So I'm going to say where, and I'm going to say I have an operator, which is like, I have a path, which is idle, and then I have a value string, let's say, yeah, this one. I know this one is in the data set. Yes, okay. So one of the things that I can now do is that I can say, well, it's off category, and I can say on category, and then the name of the category. So the result that you will see now is null, and that's done on purpose. So we prepared the data set that there's no category currently related to the article. But if we look at the actual categories that we have, oh, sorry, get things, category, name. So here you see all the categories that we have. So those are just categories, environmental, science, religion, politics, media, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that can somehow be related to a to an article. So what we can do now is that we can actually run a query to try to estimate what the category would be for this article about Picasso. So if you go to the contextual classification, it's here, it's explained how it works, but there's also an example. So what we can do is this. We can run a query. So let me clear this. Say curl. And then we say v1 classification. See that I do that correctly. Of course, classifications. I need to set a header. And is on. And then the data that we're going to send is something that I'm going to take from the, just copy paste from the example. So what we see here is like, we're looking at the class article. The properties that we want to classify is where you can classify multiple properties, but we're now going to classify one property, which is off category. So which we see here, so off category is now null. So that's the one that we want to classify. We want to do it based on a property. Well, here it says summary, but I have title here, so I need to change it to title. And we want to use the contextual type of classification. So if I now add that here, change summary to title, and then for readability, I can actually pipe that out to JQ. So just one more time. So we just do a request to the API, to the classifications endpoint. The content type is just a JSON. We want to classify the article. The property we want to classify is off category. We want to do that based on the title, and the type is contextual. So if I now run this, we get an object back that says the classification is currently running, the type that is running, and it comes with an ID, which is handy, because one of the things that we can do is that we can say, copy and this one again, curl slash v1 slash classifications, and I can add the ID. So especially when you have large data sets, this is not a very big data set, but if you have large data sets, this is handy because you can actually read out the status of the classification. So you can see when it started. Well, you can see it's not completed yet also, because it says that the status is running. So let's look at that again. Yeah, and we see that it's completed. So we see how many classifications it did that completed, and that's contextual. So that would mean that if I now run this same query again, that the category of the Picasso paintings should not be null anymore. So it should have classified it towards something. So if I now run this query, then we see that it categorized that around art. So that's the structure. That's an example of the classification. That's also something we would love to get feedback from the community, how you use this, where you see that we can make improvements. And then last but not least, also when you're done using the cluster we've yet. Client. Sorry, we've yet CLI, of course. Help. And then when you're done, you can actually say, or you can say, leave V8 CLI cluster remove. Do you want to remove the cluster? Yes, I want to. And that's it. So now you see that the cluster is being removed. So if I now try to get access to it again, you see it's gone. It has disappeared. So that means that if you want to get started with VV8, there are three ways how you can currently do that. I mean, we talk about the open source version. One is through Docker Compose. That's ideal for just running it on your local machine. It's very easy to get that started because it's just running these three commands and you're good to go. Option two is through the CLI tool, so that you can create the cluster. We will offer this as soon as possible, also just with a web interface on the website. And last but not least is your production setup for Kubernetes. We see a lot of people who go straight to Kubernetes, which of course is fine if you want to. But we highly recommend if you want to just play around with it, just use the Docker Compose setup. It's very easy to use. You can use the data set to play around with that. And of course, the data set is also available in the... let me find an example. Is also available here, actually. So you can also play around it here. So you can just click those links, and you can actually manipulate also these... you can actually manipulate these queries as well. So you can just start playing around with it. But then, of course, you only have one data set to play with. The sandboxes that's what I just showed. We call them sandboxes. And then last but not least, I wanted to ask if anybody has any questions that I can answer, or if there's anything that people would like to know. So
yes,
go ahead, David.